We'll go ahead and get started tonight. Appreciate everybody being here. Thank you so much for your presence. Just so glad to have everybody here and hear all this fellowship going on. I'm very excited tonight for what we got going on. I'm going to lead us in a couple of songs, but then Hampton is going to come and talk to us. I was trying to think of something different to do tonight, and with it being football time, I had the idea for Hampton. He's going to come and he's going to talk to us about some spiritual lessons he's learned from playing football this season. And then Coach Ryan Hall is going to come up here and he's going to deliver us a short thought on some spiritual lessons that he has gained this season through coaching this team. And so I'm excited about that. I think we'll all be able to get a lot out of that from both Hampton and Ryan. So thankful for them stepping up and doing this for us. To get us started, Grant's going to come and lead us in an opening prayer. Then I'll lead a few songs, then we'll turn it over to Hampton.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the opportunity you've given us to come and fellowship together tonight. I'm thankful for everyone that's here. I'm thankful for Hampton and for Ryan coming and giving us a piece of your word tonight. We pray that we'll all be attentive and we'll all take something with us. We pray that you'll be with us as we worship you. Help us to do everything tonight in spirit and in truth, and help us to carry your word out into the world this week. It's in your son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior,
to be a heaven that be fine. thank you, Kelly, for asking me to do this. But I've learned many things playing football, and the most important thing that I've probably learned is that you can do everything right, and like you can work really hard in practice, you can be dependable, you can be a great teammate, but none of these things guarantee success. And this reminds me of Job in the Bible. Job 1:1 says, "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil." Job was blameless. He was complete. He was a solid man. He feared God. He was a godly man. He stayed away from evil. If you look at Job, you see a man that did a lot right. Yet there was a period in his life where he didn't get what he wanted. He went through tremendous trials and struggles even though he was a godly man. My experience with football hasn't been as tough as Job, but I'm reminded when things don't go how I want them to, that I must press on. How I respond to the struggles is what is important. Just as Job maintained his course and kept doing good, I have to keep doing the right things and rewards will come in time. This is what I've learned from playing football.
I don't know if I can follow that. That was really good, Nat. Good job. Appreciate it, Kelly. I appreciate you giving us this opportunity, and it's really neat to do that with Hampton. I'm going to tell you a story real quick, and I've never told this story. I've heard it several times, and it's really been powerful to me, but I want to share it with you. I hope I can get it right. But it's a story of a man named Joe Davis. He had a son named Donald Davis, who he's a world-renowned storyteller. That's what he does. He goes and tells stories. He does it at shows. But I heard him tell this story when he was growing up one day. His dad, they lived in Waynesville, North Carolina, which is a small town in the mountains, very rural. And his dad's name was Joe. There were several Joes in the town. And so they would call the Joes by a nickname, like one of them's name was Joe Silas because Silas was his middle name. And one of them's name was Joe the Mechanic because he worked on cars. And Donald's dad, Joe, he was known as Banker Joe. And so as Donald grew up, he had heard his dad called Banker Joe over and over and over again. Well, one day when he was about 12 years old, he was at the bank with his dad, and they came out, and across the way was a man that kind of waved, and his dad waved back, and he said, "Hey, Mike, how's it going?" And Mike yelled back across, "Hey, Cripple Joe, it's great to see you." And the little boy, Donald, it kind of took him aback. It stunned him. You know, you could imagine that at that time, the little boy thought, "Man, that guy's saying something cruel to my dad. That's pretty mean." So as they walk off, the dad, Joe, he could tell something was wrong with the son. And they got in the car, and he said, "What's wrong? What's the problem?" He said, "I didn't like when that man called you Cripple Joe." Dad said, "Well, let me tell you a story why that is. I haven't seen that man in many, many years. The last time he saw me, that's kind of what they referred to me as, and I'll tell you why." So he goes into this story, and he tells them, "When I was a little boy, I lived with 8 other kids, and we had a shop, and my brothers, they would all go out and work and cut wood and do different things out there in the shed, and we had a little farm that they would take care of, I was out there watching them one day, and I said, 'Hey, can I swing that axe?' to one of my brothers, and they're like, 'No, you're too young, you'll get hurt.' And so my mom called for us to come eat, and so my brothers and my dad kind of eased off, and I snuck around the back, and I said, 'This is my opportunity. I'm going to get to go in and play with all those tools and mess with those tools that they were doing.' So he hung back. When they left, he got a small axe with a sharp blade that they'd been cutting that wood with, and he started swinging it in there, and he was cutting some, splitting wood, and his mom yelled again, Donald, come to dinner. So he said, 'I better go or they're going to figure it out. I'm down here messing with these tools.' Well, he swung it one more time to try to stick it back in that blade of wood, and he missed and hit himself right in the kneecap. It split his knee, and so his dad comes running back out, and he gets Joe, and he puts him in the car, and he takes him down to the local doctor. The doctor said, "We're going to cut his leg off from the knee down. There's no way I can fix it." Well, his dad gathers him up, wraps him in a blanket, takes him down to the train station, and they can catch a train to a place called Murphy, North Carolina, which will take him to Atlanta. He was just trying to get to the biggest city he could. Well, this is in the early 1900s, 1906, I think. So they go to Atlanta. The doctor fixes his knee, but he's not able to he had such a gash in his knee he could never bend it again, so he walked around with a limp. And because of that limp, he couldn't go out and work in the fields, and he couldn't do the work that his brothers and his dad did. And so as he grew up, he had to find, that was what most boys did in those days. Men did was they worked laborious jobs. Well, he was unable to do that. So he found a college in Charlotte, North Carolina called the King's Business School. And he enrolled in it and he learned how to be a loan officer, a banker. And he became the only loan officer in Waynesville, North Carolina. So through the years, he told his son, I've helped hundreds of people, thousands of people get money that they needed for different things. I've helped them delay payments on things. He said, I've been the only banker in this town forever. And he said, you know, that guy was calling me Cripple Joe because that's what I was known for before I became Banker Joe, what you know me as. And his son kind of looked at him strange, and the dad said, here's the lesson in that, though. The reason I'm telling you this story is there's a lesson. And he said, if it wasn't for Cripple Joe, I would have never been Banker Joe, and I would have never been able to help all those people. And he said, the lesson you need to learn in this is what most people see as tragedy can be triumph in your life. And he said this quote, and this is what stuck with me as I thought when Kelly asked me this, to talk about different lessons I've learned coaching football, not just in this season, but many more, is adversity will buy you a ticket to a place that you otherwise couldn't go. And in that story, what Joe Davis is saying is, what many people saw as a tragic situation, I really lost my ability to walk, and I lost my ability to do all the things that other young men did during that time, which was go out and labor in the fields and... But because of that, my course changed, and I became Banker Joe. And so Donald Davis, the son that was there that day that got hurt when his dad was called, that tells that story, and he tells it well. But as I was reading that, I thought about James, and I've talked about James here before, but if you study the first book of James, it's almost the same story. And I'm going to compare these two stories, and then I'll close the lesson down. But James is written by the Lord's brother, most scholars think, and he's writing it to a group of new Christians that are dispersed out. They've been ran out of their homes, and he's telling them to count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking for nothing. In any, whether it's coaching or just life in general, there's going to be adversity. There's going to be tough times. There's going to be trials. And what James is telling these people in this situation is, when those trials happen, count it all joy. Well, how do you do that? Then break my leg. I put an axe in my leg. I get happy because I did that. I'm smiling. That's not what he's referencing there. There's a reason you count it all joy, and it's because what verse 3 says, that you know that when your faith is tested, it'll produce a steadfastness, which that means you'll stand firm. It's a military term, meaning I'm immovable. You can't move me. I'm firm. You'll develop a toughness. And when that toughness has its full effect, you'll be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. He goes on to say, if you lack wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting. So, when adversity hits and tough times hit, difficulty hits, what he's telling us there is take our mind to joy, because we know that this struggle is going to bring us out the other side better if I can manage it and I can get through it in the right mindset. Down in verse 12, he says, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he received the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. Back in verse 4, he says, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking for nothing. Perfect there does not mean without flaw. It means you're whole. You are what God, you become what God designed you to become. And I think it's neat in this, as you study this, the next thing he says to him, if you lack wisdom, sometimes we don't understand why the adversity's happening. We don't know why it's happening. But here he says, if you do lack wisdom, if you lack understanding, ask God. A lot of times I've heard people say it, don't question God, but I believe right here what it's saying is, if you don't understand, question God, ask God. It's okay. God, why is this happening? Why am I going through this? And the reality of that is, you may not know, he may not tell you in that moment why you're going. It may be years down the road before you know. I've had experience where you look back, and I'm sure you have too, where today I look back and I go, I see why that happened now. I know exactly why that happened. But if I would have known in the moment, I wouldn't have been okay with it. If I would have known in that moment that I was going to lose my job, and God would have told me, well, I'm going to place you over here. I'm going to help you. You're going to be over here in 5 or 6 years, and it's going to be better. It's going to be better than you can imagine right now. I said, I'm good where I'm at. I want this job, or I want this. And so what he's saying there is, if you don't understand, ask God. And then you got to be patient for the answer. And so the lesson for me, and the best thing that I've learned through coaching, I think, is that adversity is all around you, and it's going to hit in a lot of different ways, and it's going to hit you in ways that you're not prepared for, and you're going to have to face it. And you're going to have to walk in rooms when things ain't going well, and you're going to have to look people in the eye and just deal with it. And you're going to have to get through that with your head up and chin up. And I think that's what sports in general and coaching football has taught me, is you're going to have tough times. And the reality, just standing up here, I feel almost guilty saying that, because coaching football and tough times in football are not tough times. They're really not that tough of times. But I do think it has prepared me for the times in life where it is tough, that I've had to get back up and I've had to stand up and I've had to go and face people when I didn't want to. When you get beat 42-0, you don't want to walk and look people in the eye, but you have to. And that's what it teaches you, is to overcome adversity and stand up even when things are not going good. And if you can do that, to close the lesson out, if you can do that, it'll buy you a ticket to places you had no idea you can go. Just like James said, it'll make you complete. It'll make you whole. It will make you the person that God has designed you to be.
I'm going to do one more song, 608. 608. Just want to thank Hampton and Ryan for doing that. And I know, hope you're like me and were able to get a lot out of that. But I just been thinking a lot today and recently. I hope everyone in here knows how blessed we are with the type of young people that we have at this church. Because, Hampton tonight, and then Easton this morning, and Carson and all these other guys who have participated just today, a lot of people don't have that. And we're very blessed with them. But also, I've been around young people since I was youth group, since I was 10 to 12 years old. And today, I'm on the committee at Exposure Youth Camp, on the board at Indian Creek, and I'm able to spend a lot of time with a lot of youth groups and a lot of young people. And we have a good number, but I know we don't have the biggest youth group. We might not have the biggest youth group in the world, but you'd be hard-pressed to find a better group of kids than we have at this church. I mean, these kids are just the absolute salt of the earth, and I'm honored to be able to work with them on a daily basis. So let's finish with this song, 608. I did have a couple of announcements. We want to pray for Tommy and Sandra Ayers. They're both having some problems, and we just want to be praying for them, especially this week. And also, Mark told me Kayla Hensley is being induced into labor at the hospital tomorrow, so we definitely want to be praying for her as they have this this awesome opportunity ahead of them starting tomorrow. I'm going to ask Bert Fuller if he will come and lead us in a closing prayer after this song, if you're good with that. I'm going to put you on the spot, so you have to be. But 608, let's do verse 1 and 3 of 608, and then Bert will lead us in a closing prayer, and you'll be dismissed.
He took my burdens all away, up to a brighter day, he gave me a song.
Oh, praise his name. pray together. Father God, we love you and we thank you for loving us like you do and being so mindful of our needs and blessing us so wonderfully. We're grateful for the time you've given us to be together today to worship you. And we hope, Father, that all the things we've done have brought the proper honor and glory to you. And we thank you for giving us time to fellowship with one another, too, and to grow stronger with the bonds that we have here as a family and in this congregation. We're so grateful, Father, for the men who lead us as elders here. And we pray that you'll continue to watch over them, bless them with courage, wisdom, and strength to lead as they should, and bless us with the good sense to follow them as we ought to. We ask, Father, that you'll be with with our friends that are suffering and that are struggling with things, Father. And that you'll bless them and use us to help them. We thank you for Jesus and all this, ask all this in his name. Amen.